Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
Talking earlier about separation, and I know separation is not a popular subject, and I know people don't like to hear about it because today what's politically correct to talk about is unity and getting everybody together and not splitting everybody apart. And we do want to have one mind with all the saints. Paul talks about the saints having one mind. But a judgment, the very fact that there is a judgment, implies a separation. You ever thought about that? So if you're going to preach about judgment, you're actually preaching about separation. What's the separation? Well, look here in Matthew, the 13th chapter. Matthew, the 13th chapter. And it says in verses 47 to 49, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore, and they sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but threw the bad away. See, there was a separation there. So we'll be at the end of the age. The angels will come forth, separate the wicked from among the just. Well, why? Here's what some people ask. They say, why are there so many churches? Well, that is a fair question, but it is not at all difficult to answer It's answered actually in many places in the book Great Controversy. We read this morning the words of the Puritan pastor when he talked about how the Lutherans wouldn't go any farther than Luther went. The Calvinists won't go any farther than Calvin went. The Mennonites won't go any farther than Menno Simon went. And on and on and on. People follow a leader, but then they stop. Now, I hesitate to give current day examples, but I think I'm going to, even though it's dangerous, because I want you to think. When I was a young person, there was a minister, a very godly minister. I knew him. My parents became acquainted with this minister before I was born. My parents became acquainted with this minister in 1941. And so we knew this minister very well. He had stayed in our home. I had been with him, I don't know how many hours. His wife taught me when I was about 19 years old how to give Bible studies. I took a class on how to give Bible studies. And she taught us how to give Bible, went through the subjects and how to make the presentation, what questions to ask and how to answer the common objections and all those things. We knew this man very well. His name was W.D. Frazee. He was one of the founders of Wildwood Sanitarium Hospital and Medical Missionary Institute. And he was a very godly man. And I hope to be with him in heaven. I have no question about that. But, this is a big but, Elder Frazee was a leader in the cause of revival and reformation in Adventism, and he was sending tapes. They had reel-to-reel tapes in those days, about that big reel, sending them all over the world. And these tapes were a marvelous blessing. But, this is a big but, God's work did not stop when Elder Frazee retired or when he died. God's work didn't stop there. God's work is in a different position now than it was in the 50s or even in the 70s. And you know what happened? My parents, my father and mother, were visiting some people that, and these people also, we'd known them for about 50 years. And so they were talking, and this gentleman, I think he's still alive as far as I know, but I don't know. He would be elderly. This gentleman told my parents he wasn't going to go any farther than Elder Frazee went. If Elder Frazee said so, then it was all right, but Elder Frazee didn't teach it, he wasn't going farther than that. And I thought, dear, oh dear. Now, friends, I loved Elder Frazee. That's not the question. But friends, God's work is progressive. God is leading a people. And when you won't go farther than somebody went, and they died 10 or 20 years ago, you see, that's what happened to the Jews. The Jews went up to a certain point, and they got up to that point, and they wouldn't go any farther. Do you know that's what happened with the Catholic Church during the Middle Ages? Are you aware of the fact that there were Catholic theologians, there were Catholic bishops, there were even Catholic popes that said the Church of Christ is in a terrible condition and it needs to be revived and the church needs to be reformed. In the book Great Controversy, I was reading last night, she records some speeches that some Roman Catholics gave telling how evil things were and that they needed to be reformed, they needed to be changed. Well, even though they needed to be reformed, do you know, when they met at the Council of Constance in 1414, one of the major things they met there for was they said the church needs to be reformed, and they were so in earnest about it that they deposed the Pope, got rid of the Pope, and they got another Pope. But they also, in their efforts to try to get revival reformation, they decided to burn John Huss at the stake. See, that was their way to bring about revival reformation, to keep heresy out. So, why are there so many churches? Because people follow leaders. Now, we don't like this. But we need to recognize that's the way people are. They follow leaders. Now, I'm not talking about divine leaders. I'm talking about a human leader. They follow human leaders, and they follow as far as that person went. And my dear friends, W.D. Frazee was a very godly person. I loved him. But the work of God did not stop progressing when he retired or when he died. It didn't. And we are in a completely different situation today than we were in the 50s or even in the 70s. But some people say, that's where he came, that's for all the farther I'm going to go. Now, if I was here just in a group telling stories, I could tell you, I could show you from a person that I know also know who was a very good friend of Elder Frazee's, that Elder Frazee saw the kind of time we're living in coming. He saw it and told people about it in private. He foresaw that the time was coming when the Seventh-day Adventist conferences would fight the true workers. He foresaw that time coming. He wasn't there yet quite, in the sense that we are, but he foresaw it coming. But why are there so many churches? Because people follow as far as a certain leader went, and then they won't go any farther. And not only the regular people in the church, but ministers are this way too. Are you aware of the fact that over and over again in the book Great Controversy, Ellen White predicted that there would be few ministers? This is scary if you're a minister. There will be few ministers involved in God's last work. Are you aware of that? There will be few ministers. Let me read you a few statements from the past and the present where you can see that. Remember, she said all these records she gave of the past were examples to us of what would happen in the future. Now, this is what happened in the Second Advent movement in the 1840s. She said, some ministers laid aside their sectarian views and feelings, left their salaries and their churches, and united in proclaiming the coming of Jesus. It'd be wonderful to meet some of those ministers, wouldn't it, when Jesus comes? But notice what she says next. There were comparatively few ministers, however, who would accept this message. This is the Second Advent message. Therefore, it was largely committed to humble laymen. Who was it? She says it was farmers and mechanics and traders and professional men left their positions. That's going to happen in God's last closing work. If you're looking for leaders, ministers, highly educated people, there aren't going to be very many. Now, our subject tonight is not to explain why that is. It's not difficult, if we had a couple hours to investigate that subject, to explain why in the final work there will be few highly educated people and few ministers involved. But it'll be true. In the Second Advent message, this was one of the reasons used to say, we know it's not true because the ministers haven't accepted it. Trouble is, have you ever read in your Bible about how anybody ever said that before? Do you remember what they said about Jesus? Look in your Bible, what they said about Jesus. So, this is going to happen again. This is John 7, verses 46 to 49. It says, the officers answered, no man ever spoke like this man. Then the Pharisees answered them, are you also deceived? Have any of the rulers or the Pharisees believed in him? But this crowd that does not know the law is cursed, or accursed. Interesting, isn't it? The very same thing they said about Jesus. They said at the beginning of the Second Advent movement. Is that going to happen again? Yes, it's going to happen again at the end. There will be very few ministers or highly educated people involved in the finishing of God's work. Here's another statement about this. This is in page 380. It's about the Second Advent movement, that we read about before in the 1840s. It says, the churches generally did not accept the warning. Their ministers, who as watchmen onto the house of Israel should have been the first to discern the tokens of Jesus' coming, had failed to learn the truth either from the testimony of the prophets or from the signs of the times. As worldly hopes and ambitions filled the heart, love for God and faith in His Word had grown cold, and when the Advent doctrine was presented, it only aroused their prejudice and unbelief. The fact that the message was to a great extent preached by laymen was urged as an argument against it. That's going to happen again. Let me read that to you. Prophecy, that very same thing is going to happen again. This is in Great Controversy, page 606. It says, the message of the third angel will be proclaimed as the time comes for it to be given with greatest power. The Lord will work through humble instruments, leading the minds of those who consecrate themselves to His service. The laborers will be qualified rather by the unction of His Spirit than by the training of literary institutions. Why won't God use highly educated people? The same reason He didn't use the Pharisees and the Sadducees. It's not because He wouldn't. It's because they wouldn't. They wouldn't accept the message that God had. So you need to get ready for this. When we talk about separation, we are talking about the fact that very few people that are highly educated, that are ministers, will be involved in God's last work. Actually, this has always been the way it's been, but it's going to be even more so than the last work. Ellen White says He's going to use the common people more than ever before, and that's mainly who He used before. Look here in 1 Corinthians, verse 1. 1 Corinthians, chapter 1. Oh dear, we could read all the way from verse 18 to verse 31. It's very interesting. But just look at verse 26 to 28. So you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty, and the base things of the world, that the things which are despised God has chosen, and the things which are despised God has chosen, and the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are. So, in the last great work, friends, the last great work, the message of Revelation 18 is not going to bring unity in the world. It's going to bring division. Now, it's going to bring unity among those that accept the message. But not very many people are going to accept the message in proportion to the world population. And we need to remember that God does not change the message that He wants given to the world because people don't accept it. Did God change the message in Noah's time when the world didn't accept it? No. Did God change His message in Elijah's time when they didn't accept it? No. Did God change His message in Jesus' time when the Jews didn't accept it? Did God change His message in the 16th century when the papacy wouldn't accept it? No. Did God change His message in the 1840s when the Protestant churches wouldn't accept it? No. Okay, here's the killer. Is God going to change His message if the Seventh-day Adventist Church doesn't accept it? No, He's not.
The message is not going to set to change. God says, I don't change. With him, the Bible says, there's no variableness or shadow of turning. James 1:17.
So, the cause of the problem. The cause of the problem is that cause of the darkness is because God's professed people have not been listening to his counsel for a long time. And so we need to face the facts. We have wandered away from what God has said to do and what he said not to do. That's what happened in 1844. Only now it's had the same thing that happened in 1844 is happening in Adventism. This is what happened in 1844. That's what it says. The almost universal absence of revival in the churches, the spiritual apathy is almost all pervading and is fearfully deep. This is Great Controversy, page 377. This is when they rejected the Judgment Hour message in 1844. The church members are becoming devotees of fashion. They join hands with the ungodly in parties of pleasure, in dancing and festivities. The churches generally are becoming sadly degenerate. They have gone very far from the Lord, and he has withdrawn himself from them. Here's what another writer said. We have never witnessed such a general declension of religion as at the present. Truly the church should awake and search into the cause of this affliction. For as an affliction, everyone that loves Zion must view it. When we call to mind how few and far between cases of true conversion are, and the almost unparalleled impertinence and hardness of sinners. Such a condition never exists. Now this is Ellen White writing. Such a condition never exists without cause in the church itself. The spiritual darkness which falls upon nations, upon churches and individuals, is due not to an arbitrary withdrawal of the succors of divine grace on the part of God, but to neglect or rejection of divine light on the part of men. Neglect or rejection of light on the part of men. My friends, you and I, we should be studying the Bible and the spirit of prophecy for our life. Because we're going to have to face the Lord at the end. We're going to have to face him. It's going to be a face-to-face meeting, and we're all going to be there. And friends, don't listen to the lie of the devil. The Lord is not a hard taskmaster. The judgment is not for the purpose of condemning, but the whole universe has to see that what God does is right and just. And the problem is, my daughter was talking to me about this the other day, about what we have seen happen in the last 20 years. The tremendous apostasy. I was disfellowshipped from the Seventh-day Adventist Church in 1993, and one of the four reasons they gave for doing, all four reasons that they gave for doing it were true. And one of the reasons they gave for doing it was they said, you are saying that we are in apostasy. And I said, yes, I have said that, and I'm still saying that, and the apostasy is getting worse almost every day. And people say, oh, what are you talking about? You're calling us babbling. No, I didn't say that. I just said you're in apostasy. What is apostasy anyway? Apostasy is falling away from the truth. Now, let's look at Great Controversy, page 384. And I'll show you how this apostasy begins. And then you tell me if this is going on, if you know anybody in Adventist, you tell me if this is going on in the Adventist church or not. This is page 384. It says, what was the origin of the great apostasy? How did the church first depart from the simplicity of the gospel? Now listen, here's the answer. Here's how it happened. By conforming to the practices of paganism to facilitate the acceptance of Christianity by the heathen. Notice, the way they went into apostasy was to try to get more converts. And to try to get more converts, they wanted to facilitate the church to conform more easily to the pagan society around them. So they started doing this within 20 years of the death of the apostles. We have documented evidence of that. I'll give you an example. This is one of the things they were doing within 20 years after the apostles died in some of the large centers. Among the pagans, when you became a member of a pagan religion, you had to go through an initiation ceremony. Now, by the way, you don't want yourself or your children to study everything they did in those initiation ceremonies. But they had initiation ceremonies, and the first initiation ceremony they had was, they called that the Lesser Mysteries, and then after you were graduated from that, you went into initiation ceremony that they called the Greater Mysteries. And after you came out of the Greater Mysteries, then you were a fully-fledged member. You'd gone through the initiation process. So the Christians, do you know what the Christians did? They said, you know what? We have initiation mysteries too. Now, not when Jesus was alive, they didn't. Not when the apostles were alive, they didn't. You won't read anything about that in the New Testament. In fact, the Apostle Paul wrote about these pagan mysteries, and he said in Ephesians 5, he says, it is a shame to even talk about the things that they do in secret. But the Christian said, we have initiation ceremonies too. And so they called baptism the lesser mystery, because that was first. That's how it came into the church. And then when you partook of the Lord's Supper, they called that the greater mystery. And then not only that, the heathen, they dressed the people in white robes when they came out from these. So the Christian said, they will put white robes on people too when they're baptized. So they started trying to facilitate. She says, that's how the apostasy began. During the lives of the apostles, the church remained comparatively pure. But toward the latter end of the second century, most of the churches assumed a new form. The first simplicity disappeared. And insensibly, as the old disciples retired to their graves, their children, along with new converts, came forward and new modeled the cause. To secure converts, the exalted standard of the Christian faith was lowered. And as the result, a pagan flood flowing into the church carried with it its customs, practices, and idols. As the Christian religion secured the favor and support of secular rulers, it was nominally accepted by multitudes. And then, this writer says, has not the same process been repeated in nearly every church calling itself Protestant? Has that process happened in the Adventist Church? If you've lived very long, you know it has. You know it has. I was talking to somebody the other day about, I can't remember who this was I was talking to, but when I was a young minister in the North Dakota Conference, and no conference pastor, under any condition, was allowed to baptize a woman with a wedding ring on. Not only that, but no person was allowed to be a church officer, to assume any office. That included the pianist. We had a lady in one church that I pastored who was a very good pianist, but she left the church because the church would not vote her in to be a church pianist as long as she wore a wedding ring, and she wouldn't take it off, and she got so upset about it, she left the church. They said, well, we're sorry about that, but we have standards. That's the way it was. Now, I was in the church when this was all changed. In Texas, it happened in 1983. I was right there when it happened. And when you're there and you know what it was because you were a minister before, you have to ask yourself the question. If you're a consistent logical thinker, you have to ask yourself this question. Namely, were we wrong then, or are we wrong now? Now, by the way, I'm not saying that everything we did back then was right. I'm not saying that.
And I'm not saying that everything we're doing now is wrong. But when you change directions and you go in the opposite direction, one of them has to be wrong. They both can't be right. How did the apostasy start? It has started when they tried to conform to the world. They wanted to conform to the world in their educational practices. The way they dressed and the way they ate and what kind of entertainment they engaged in. If you study the history of Sunday laws, you'll find that by the 4th century, it had gotten so bad that when they made laws so that people couldn't work on Sunday, they still didn't go to church, because when they couldn't work, they just went to the circus. These are the Christians. So to get the Christians not to go to the circus and to come to church, they had to make laws to close down the circuses, to close down all the places of amusement. Well, when they made laws to close down the places of amusement, the people still didn't go to church. They just stayed home. And so then they finally had to make the laws more stringent. They said they not only had to close down the places of amusement, but they had to make a law that on Sunday you had to go to church. Because the people wouldn't be good any other way, you had to make a law to make them good. That's where we're headed again, by the way. On page 387 here in Great Controversy, it says, "In this tide of worldliness and pleasure-seeking, self-denial and self-sacrifice for Christ's sake are almost wholly," that's completely, "lost. If funds are wanted, nobody must be called on to give. Oh, no. Have a fair to blue, mock trial, antiquarian supper, or something to eat, something to amuse the people." That's why today, if you want to gamble, the churches have become large gambling facilities, some of them. That's the way they raise money. If you understand how gambling works, some of you certainly must know how gambling works. These slot machines and all these different games that people play, those games are rigged. They're rigged by the casino or the house establishment who is ever running the program. So a few times people win money, but it's rigged on a mathematical basis so that in the long run, you may go and win some money, but the house is going to win more than the people and the gamblers win. That's just the way it's going to be, because the system's rigged. That's the way all the slot machines work, and that's the way all that is. Well, in the time in which we're living, notice what Ellen White said about this. This to me is a really scary statement, because when we look at what is happening in Adventism today, listen to this statement. "All who are not decided followers of Christ are servants of Satan." If you're not a decided follower of Christ, that's page 508. If you're not a decided follower of Christ, you're what? You're a servant of Satan. You remember what we read earlier? Between the servants of Christ and the servants of Satan, there can be no fellowship. There can be no association. There has to be separation. It won't work. If you associate, let me just read that here. It says, "In their unregenerate heart there is love of sin and a disposition to cherish and excuse it. In the renewed heart there is hatred of sin and determined resistance against it. When Christians choose the society of the ungodly and unbelieving, they expose themselves to temptation. Satan conceals himself from view and stealthily draws his deceptive covering over their eyes. They cannot see that such company is calculated to do them harm. And while all the time assimilating to the world in character, words, and actions, they are becoming more and more blinded. Conformity to worldly customs converts the church to the world. Familiarity with sin will inevitably cause it to appear less repulsive." And my friends, that is what has happened and is happening in Adventism today. I'm not saying this to condemn somebody, anybody. I'm saying it because you need to think through, who are you associating with, and what effect is it having on you and the members of your family? And this is what we see when we look around. people that associate with other people in a church that tolerates open sin. And you know what open sin is. Open sin is when God has said to do something or not do something, and people are going directly contrary to that. That's breaking the first commandment. And if you're associating, if you're in a church where open sin is tolerated, and you're associating with people that are engaging in it, and by the way, let's just face it, be blunt. All this gold that people are decking on themselves, whether it's rings or bracelets or necklaces or whatever it is, it's all over the place. That is forbidden in the Word of God. Read what Paul said about it in 2 Timothy. That's forbidden. But if you associate with people that dress that way and adorn themselves that way, this is what we've observed. After you've associated with them for a while, you will eventually end up dressing and adorning yourself like the people you're associating with. That's just what happens. I could show you case after case. My wife has showed me pictures on Facebook I just could hardly believe. What's happened? Well, there's been a separation. And there's a lot of people that call themselves Adventists that are becoming assimilated to the world. And if you talk to them, they don't even know. I've talked to some of them. They don't even seem to know anything's happened. That's what's the most scary thing of all to me. When I talk to some of these people, they don't know anything's even happened. There's been a separation and they don't even know anything's happened. Well, let's look particularly at in the few minutes we have left, let's look at what's going to happen in the last remnant of time. We already studied earlier that in the last remnant of time, that the devil, the spiritualism is the devil's masterpiece. She talks about two masterpieces in the book Great Controversy. She says that the papacy is a masterpiece of satanic wisdom. She talks about that on page 50 and 51. And she says on page 555, 560, she says that spiritualism is a masterpiece of deception. And the devil's going to use both of those masterpieces of deception at the end. And here on page 580, she says, those who reject the light of truth will yet seek the aid of this self-styled infallible power to exalt an institution that originated with her. So the people that reject the light of truth are going, she says, they're going to seek the help from the papacy. Has that been done today? One of the most scary things is how close the Adventist Church has gotten to the papacy. This has been going on for a long time. I remember clear back, and this is 25 years ago. This is in 1984. And my brother was a conference pastor right near the General Conference headquarters in Maryland. And he made arrangements to have a prophecy seminar in a hospital. Now, they arranged so that they could have it in the cafeteria. It was a great big room in this Adventist hospital, have a prophecy seminar. And they sent out probably 50,000 flyers all over that area. And you know what happened? The chaplain said, you know, we're trying to be friends with the Catholics. We can't be talking about stuff like this. So after the flyers were already gone out, they'd already spent thousands of dollars, they told them, you can't meet here. This is an Adventist institution. You've already made all the arrangements. You've sent out the advertising. Now they say you can't meet there. So I was right there when this happened. They had the first meeting. They allowed them to have the first meeting. And then the second meeting, they had to go somewhere else. So they quick arranged it so that they could get another building that their church owned and had it there. And then they had to have somebody at that hospital the rest of the meeting so the people that would come, they would be redirected to the new location. And that happened 25 years ago. Something similar happened right in College Place. They're going to have Joe Cruz there, and some people say, oh, we've been trying to develop good relations with the Catholic for years, and we've got good relations, so we can't have somebody like that preaching. You see, the third angel's message, you can't even preach it in the Adventist centers anymore. There's been a separation. Look what it says in page 588.
She says the line of distinction between professed Christians and the ungodly is now hardly distinguishable. Hardly distinguishable. Through spiritualism, Satan appears as a benefactor of the race, healing the diseases of the people and professing to present a new and more exalted system of religious faith. But at the same time, he works as a destroyer. Well, we have come to interesting times when it's difficult to preach the three angels' messages to Adventists. And one of the things that Ellen White predicted that has already happened, you can read this in Great Controversy, page 592. She said that we are going to be accused of disaffection toward government. Now, we need to be careful that we are not critical of the government. That's not our business. But we're going to be accused of disaffection toward the government, and I've already seen that sort of thing happen in the court case involving Rafael Perez. Only the people that were accusing us were the Seventh-day Adventists. What is the last great delusion that's going to happen? And this is going to cause a separation, but people think it'll cause great unity. It says, the last great delusion is soon to open up before us. Antichrist is to perform his marvelous works in our sight. But in the midst of all this troubles, God is going to have a people. And here's the way they're described. I want to be one of these people. It says, God will have a people upon the earth to maintain the Bible and the Bible only as the standard of all doctrines and the basis of all reforms. The opinions of learned men, the deductions of science, the creeds or decisions of ecclesiastical councils, as numerous and discordant as are the churches which they represent, the voice of the majority, not one nor all of these, should be regarded as evidence for or against any point of religious faith. Before accepting any doctrine or precept, we should demand a plain, thus saith the Lord, in his support. That's what we have to have. Does the Bible, do the inspired writings say this? But the devil's in the process of trying to exalt human authority to rule the conscience. That's the whole history of the papacy. That's the history of religious intolerance. And that's what's going to happen again at the end. Human authority will be exalted, and the devil will try by every manner to bind people to himself. Now, how does the devil bind people? The devil is a skillful general to bind people so that they can't be part of God's people. I run into this constantly. One of the ways the devil binds people is by their affections. Did you know that? And Ellen White talked about how the devil binds people by means of their affections. This is the way she described it. She says, many are the ways by which Satan works through human influence to bind his captives. He secures multitudes to himself by attaching them by the silken cords of affection to those who are enemies of the cross of Christ. Whatever this attachment may be it parental, that's your parents, filial, that's friendship, close relationship, conjugal, that's husband and wife, or social, the effect is the same. The opposers of truth exert their power to control the conscience, and the souls held under their sway have not sufficient courage or independence to obey their own convictions of duty. So, we have had, I've seen it happen over and over again, we've had members in our church right here. They want to do what's right, but then they marry somebody who is just of the world, and they go downhill. We've seen that happen over and over and over again. We've been told, of course, in the Bible not to do that. The Bible says, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. That's 2 Corinthians 6:14-18. It says, you be separate from what's unclean, from the unfaithful, the unbelievers. As we draw near to the end, the separation between those that serve God and those that don't serve God is going to become more and more evident and apparent. Ellen White talks about this in some detail on page 602 of Great Controversy. And as we draw right up to the end, there is going to be a distinct separation between God's people and all the rest of the world. And I want to read to you a short statement from Great Controversy, page 635, that I have pondered many times in the last few years. This is the beginning of chapter 40. And it's about when there's been a death decree pronounced against God's people. And it says, as the time appointed in the decree draws near. So you're drawing close to the time appointed in the decree when God's people can all be killed. And they are all to be killed. She says, the people will conspire to root out the hated, you know what the next word is? Sect. S-E-C-T. I have pondered that sentence and that word many times. Do you remember what Seventh-day Adventist leaders did in the 1950s and why they did it? We won't go into all that history. We're about out of time. But Seventh-day Adventists, did you know that Seventh-day Adventists used to be known as a sect? A cult? And people said, you people aren't Christians because you don't believe, you know, you don't believe the nature of Christ the way everybody else does, or you don't believe this or that the way everybody else does. And let's see here. Look at Acts 28, verse 22. This is when Paul comes to Rome. Acts 28, 22. It says, we desire to hear from you what you think. For concerning this sect, we know that it is spoken against everywhere. What was that sect? That was God's people, the Christian church. It was called a sect, and it was spoken against how far? Everywhere. I have pondered this statement in Great Controversy many times. In the 1950s, leaders in the General Conference said, and I've heard them say this, I'm not reporting to you some eaves, I have heard Elder Anderson, when he was alive, who was one of the leaders in what was done in the 50s, I've heard him report directly. When I was in Loma Linda, he was retired then, and he reported to us directly what they were doing and why they were doing it, and he said, we were doing it because we didn't want to be called a sect. We wanted to be known as a Christian church. Interesting thing is, God's people at the end are not going to be known as a Christian church. Did you know that? That puts a little different twist on this, all this drive we've had now for over 50 years to be accepted among mainline Protestant churches and by the Catholic Church as a Christian church. What are God's people going to be known at the end? What did we read here? This is page 635 in Great Controversy. As the time appointed in the decree draws near, the people will conspire to root out the hated sect. What's that talking about? Friends, that's talking about separation. The people that are God's people at the end will not be part of the mainline Christian churches. Now, I don't know what's going to happen to the Adventist church. I'm not a prophet. All I know is if they stay one of the mainline Christian churches like they're trying to be right now, they're not going to be part of this group here. And this group here is the people that God's going to deliver.
I want to be part of this group. I want to be part of this hated sect.
Well, she goes on to say, you go on and read later, that as we draw nearer to the end, and God delivers his people, and people all of a sudden wake up and get figured out that their leaders have led them to hell while they profess to be leading them to paradise, they're going to be so angry that they're going to go and they're going to start killing their clergy. That's going to happen all over the world. Like I told you this morning, if anybody, if an angel from heaven or anybody told you what actually is going to happen in the future, it would be impossible for your mind to believe or comprehend it. What's going to happen is beyond comprehension. Ellen White says that, talking about this time, she said the ruin all over the world will be worse than what happened at the destruction of Jerusalem. Now that is, if you have read the first chapter of Great Controversy and you read about the destruction of Jerusalem, that just beyond your comprehension. It's beyond your comprehension. But that's what's going to happen in the future. Now, in closing, we as human beings, we're creatures of time and space, and we get information on the basis of what we hear with our ears and see with our eyes and feel with our fingers or taste and smell. But when we're talking about separation, a long time before there's an actual physical separation that human beings can see, a person is starting to veer away from the truth in their mind. And that's what we need to focus on if we want to remain and be faithful till the end. I read this before. I want to read it again. This is on page 666 in Great Controversy. This is at the end of the millennium. She says, as soon as the books of record are opened and the eye of Jesus looks upon the wicked, they are conscious of every sin which they have ever committed. They see just where their feet diverged. Now, we've been talking about separation. They see where their feet have diverged. Now, to diverge means to separate. That's what the word diverge means. To diverge from anything is to separate from it. They see just where their feet diverged from the path of purity and holiness, just how far pride and rebellion have carried them in the violation of the law of God. One of the things that has been very interesting for me to study, because I'm old enough that I've been able to see some things happen that children just can't comprehend, and that is when people start to diverge, they don't know where they're going to end up. And I've said myself sometimes, and I've heard other people say, oh, we'll do this, but we're not going to do that. We're not going to go that far. Give an example. Now, this is not a nice example, but this really happened. There was pressure by some students at a Seventh-day Adventist university that I won't mention the name, several years ago. They said, because they had some rules. They had some dress rules. Now, I believe in dress rules. I don't believe that we should make rules that aren't in the Bible, but I believe that we should follow Bible teaching. And the Bible teaching teaches modesty. And they said, here's what they said. They said, we want permission to wear Bermuda shorts. Now, Bermuda shorts come down just to right above the knee. Now, they hadn't been allowed that, but they said, that's all we want.
And when that happened, there was somebody that was wise. And they said, if you open that door and allow that, your people will be wearing short shorts clear up to here within a year. Well, you know what? It didn't even take a year. It's just the same as when the wedding ring controversy was in Keene in 1983, and I've told you about that before. And the head deacon came to my office and said, when we allow this, we've opened the door, and within a year, you're going to see the women in this church wearing studs in their ears and a bunch of other stuff. And I was naive, I guess. I said, no, I don't believe. They want to wear a wedding ring, and I'm not in favor of that, but I don't believe they'll do that. Well, I was wrong. He was right. You see, the only safe thing for you and me to do is to look in the Bible, in the Spirit of Prophecy, and say, what does God say to do, and what does He say not to do, and then just listen. Because when you start to diverge, when you start to do something that God's Word says, don't do that, or not do something that God's Word says to do, when you start to diverge, you don't know where you're going to end up. And we are seeing today an avalanche of worldliness come in among God's people that we thought years ago that this couldn't even happen. We couldn't comprehend such a thing. The immodesty, the jewelry, which is forbidden in God's Word, we'll read what Paul and Peter said about it. What we're doing for entertainment and recreation, what we're reading, what we're listening to, what we're looking at, we used to say just a few years ago, that's wrong. Well, were we wrong then or are we wrong now? Friends, we are in a serious apostasy from inspired writings. We need to face the facts. Why am I saying this? Why am I alarmed? Because I talk to my family, I say, wait a minute. I'll tell my daughter this. Whatever you see other people doing, remember, they're not the standard. Well, no matter what you see them doing, it doesn't matter how many of them there are, even if you're the only one left. If you want to go to heaven, you better study your Bible and then do what the Bible says and not do what the Bible says not to do. And just say, if I'm the only one, well, so be it. I'll be the only one. Right now, where my daughter works, there's a special project that everybody was supposed to come late this afternoon. My daughter says, I will not be there until after sundown. Why? Oh, they're only starting to do this project about 15 minutes before sundown. What if you break that line? You know what happens if you break that line? Well, if it's only 15 minutes a day, sometime down the line it'll be half an hour, and sometime other would be an hour. And so she said, no, I won't be, I'll come and help you Saturday night, but I won't be there until, I won't even start until after sundown. Why? Because God has drawn a line. God says, this is your time, this is my time. You're to devote this time to me. And it doesn't matter what it is, whether it's the edges of the Sabbath or what it is. When God has drawn a line and He says, this is the way, this, be on this side, I want to be on the same side of the line that God is on. How about you? Because there's a separation. The separation is offered. You're on the same side of the line God is on, or if you're on the other side. Well, we're more than out of time. Let's pray and ask the Lord to help us. Father in heaven, I pray for each person here. We know that a separation is taking place now in the hearts and minds of men and women. And there is going to be a worldwide separation very soon. And there will be only a few people who accept the truth. It'll be like it was in the days of Noah. But Lord, we want to be on your side of the line. We want to be those people that are living in harmony with everything that is written in inspired writings. Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters who are becoming assimilated to the world and don't realize what is happening. Lord, if there's any way that you can use us to help them to wake up and realize that they're headed down the broad road to destruction, show us how and what we can do to help them to turn around. We pray in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.